Hachette Audio presents Race Against Time, The Politics of a Darkening America, written and read by Keith Boykin. Introduction. Our Weary Year. The year began in a cold, dreary vestibule of a former women's prison in Mexico City. A few minutes past midnight in the first hour of 2020, I walked through an open cage, past a row of locked jail cells, and into the unusual venue of the New Year's Eve party to which I had been invited. I watched young people in jeans and t-shirts dancing to house music and non-binary stage performers gyrating their bodies on pedestals. This was not the Mexico of the American tourist stereotypes of mariachi bands and wide-brimmed sombreros, nor was it the Mexico that America's current president had described when he first launched his campaign. It was a country that was evolving with modern times, much like ours, and it reminded me just how much that change frightened so many people in my own country. I had not expected to start the new year in this space, but like so much of what would happen in 2020, things did not work out as planned. 12 months of covering an unwieldy Democratic presidential campaign and a pre-Christmas presidential impeachment left me racing to catch my breath in the final days of December 2019. As a reward to myself, I booked a trip to Mexico to relax and prepare for the year to come. I was eager to try a non-traditional celebration venue as a symbol of my openness to the possibilities of a new year. And as I walked from one dark cage room to another, I interpreted my New Year's Eve adventure as a sign that the year ahead might also be filled with exhilarating new experiences. But perhaps, I considered later, it was actually an omen that I would soon find myself in jail. Sometime after I woke up from my hangover on New Year's Day, my travel partners convinced me to take an Uber to the Linda Vista neighborhood for yet another unusual activity. This involved a Mexican shaman who cleansed my body with burning sage and instructed me to kneel in front of an igloo-shaped heat lodge and ask Omoteolt, the god of duality, for permission to enter the Temescal. I had never heard of any of these things before, but I gamely went along, crawling shirtless into the cramped space of the igloo until the tiny doors were closed, and I found myself suffocating from the hot, stifling steam of the volcanic rock in the pitch-black chamber. A few minutes into the ceremony, I panicked and demanded to leave. The shaman tried to calm my nerves, but I was too frightened to relax. I clumsily stepped over the four other people in the Temescal, crawled my way out the door, and exhaled when I finally stood alone in the daylight. When the shaman came out to check on me later, I explained that I have claustrophobia and could not return for the remainder of the 40-minute ceremony. We had a brief discussion and negotiated a compromise. I agreed to return, but only if I could sit closest to the exit with my hand on the door. That simple technique allowed me to relax and survive the remainder of the ordeal. I had no idea at the time, but this experience would also serve as a valuable lesson for the calm I would need to call upon to face the challenges of 2020. 2 days later, I loaded my bags into a car to the airport as the trip came to an end. I knew I was returning to political drama in the United States that I had successfully avoided for 7 days, but I did not know that I, along with everyone else on the planet, would soon find myself unable to travel to international destinations. As the car drove past Parque Mexico, I said goodbye to my peaceful week in our rental apartment in the quiet neighborhood of La Condesa, and I braced myself for the year to come. Shortly after I arrived home in New York, I started feeling the effects of a strange illness so serious that it left me contemplating my own mortality. For several days, I left the door of my Harlem apartment locked but unlatched in case a friend with a key needed to rescue and transport me to the hospital. With the aid of the internet, I self-diagnosed my condition as everything from cancer to Montezuma's revenge. But I stubbornly refused to see a doctor because I had forgotten to renew my health insurance on the Affordable Care Act exchange. I would be without coverage until February 1st. I blame myself for becoming so distracted with the impeachment coverage that I forgot to take care of my own needs. Surely, my self-indulgent vacation was the root cause of my sickness, I thought, and I hoped a quick detox and convalescence would cure me. It took 2 weeks for my condition to improve, but it would take another 2 months before I would suspect a more alarming explanation for what had happened, that I might have been afflicted with a strange new virus that the world would soon come to know intimately. During those days of rest and recovery, I also dreaded the exhaustion the next 12 months would bring. I expected that 2020 would be dominated by two stories, an impeachment trial in January and a presidential election in November. And I knew how demanding both of those experiences could be. Only 3 U.S. presidents had been impeached in history. I had lived through 2 of those impeachments, and I remembered how the previous Senate trial consumed the nation for 5 weeks in the winter of 1999. I also remember that even the most routine election is a monumental undertaking. Having worked on 6 political campaigns as an activist and covered 6 presidential campaigns as a journalist, I thought I knew exactly what to expect. The caucuses, the primaries, the rallies, the conventions, the debates, and the campaign ads, all conducted at the lightning-fast speed of an unrelenting news cycle. What I did not know was that the country was about to experience a dramatic convulsion. 4 cataclysmic crises were about to converge at once. First, we would be thrust into a deadly public health emergency worse than any outbreak since the flu epidemic of 1918. At the same time, we would plunge into an economic crisis more disruptive than any recession since the Great Depression began in 1929. Third, a racial justice movement would emerge larger than any since the protests after Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. was assassinated in 1968. And finally, we would end the year in a crisis of democracy unlike anything seen in America since the disputed presidential election of 1876. This was not just a once-in-a-century confluence of events. It was a unique moment in our history. 4 gigantic tectonic plates would shift at the same time in America, putting into grave doubt the health of our people, the stability of our economy, the safety of our most vulnerable citizens, and the survival of our democracy. The result would shake the foundation of our nation. Of course, these crises were not simply the fallout of one epic year. They were the outgrowth of a longer national history of a broken healthcare system, an unfair economic structure, the failure to remedy centuries-old constitutional flaws, and most threatening of all, the perpetuation of white supremacy. Yet at some level, they all had to do with race. This book examines the politics of our darkening America in 3 parts. In part 1, I discuss the 4 crises of 2020, and how they led to the Capitol insurrection of 2021. In part 2, I go back in time to explore America's racist political history and the realignment of the 2 dominant political parties from the Reconstruction era to the present. And in part 3, I propose ideas to move forward. I argue that the problem of racism in American politics transcends specific political parties and leaders. From the end of Reconstruction 1877 until the Civil Rights Act of 1964, both major political parties failed black people. The Republican Party of Abraham Lincoln reneged on its promise to protect African Americans, while the racist Democratic Party of Andrew Jackson didn't even bother to try. But as the Democrats slowly began to evolve in the 1960s, one could draw a straight line in the Republican Party. From Goldwater's opposition to civil rights in 1964, to Nixon's Law and Order and War on Drugs campaigns in 1968 and 1971, to Reagan's Welfare Queen and States' Rights campaigns in 1976 and 1980, to George H.W. Bush's Willie Horton attacks in 1988, to Pat Buchanan's Culture War speech in 1992, to George W. Bush's response to Hurricane Katrina in 2005, to Donald Trump's birther campaign against President Barack Obama in 2011, and his politics of overt white nationalism through 2021. At the heart of the racism of the old Democratic Party and the devolution of the Republican Party was the same concern, the fear of a changing America and the end of white supremacy. This world is white no longer, and it will never be white again, James Baldwin wrote in 1955. Those prescient words from Notes of a Native Son ring truer today than ever before. As America has become blacker and browner, influential forces have tried to turn back the clock to stop the inevitable diversification.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.